Welcome, welcome, welcome. May I have the house lights, please? I don't like talking into darkness. Hello. My name is Glenna Gray, and I serve my community as the chairperson of the Human Rights Commission of Mamaroneck and Larchmont. It has been a great experience for me. I enjoy every part of it, the good and the bad, everything. I'm so glad you came out this evening. I see many familiar faces, and even better, I see lots of new faces. I never see any of you at Sal's Pizza, though. I'm up on the avenue, I never see any. You work, good. Well, I'm welcoming you to the 21st century, to the 13th annual Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Awards ceremony. It is one of the best ceremonies in our community. I'm not going to talk much, but I came across one of Dr. King's sayings, and since I'm a retired teacher, I can't help myself. You know how teachers are. He said so many wonderful things that it's hard to select one that covers everything. He was a fabulous American hero of the 20th century, and we look forward in the 21st century to fulfill all of his dreams. Potential powers of creativity are within us, and we have the duty to work assiduously to discover these powers. 1963. And with that, I will leave the stage and introduce to you Cora Rust, who brought the Martin Luther King Jr. Award ceremony to our community. She has worked very hard for these 13 years. Cora Rust.
Thank you. Thank you, Glenna. Thank you, Eric, for that fantastic opening to our millennium celebration of Dr. King's birthday. This is the 13th year that the Human Rights Commission is sponsoring this program. And we should feel like veterans, but we don't. We have a really good program this evening, and in this program we have a number of people who are going to be performing who have not been in our presence before. It will be something that we know you will enjoy greatly. The theme for this evening's program is This Millennium's Challenge, Awake to Dr. King's Dream Now. But in thinking back, a question comes to our minds. Because when we selected this theme, we were perhaps caught up and too involved in that Y2K brouhaha. Why should it take a millennium, a century, or even 10 years to address the dream? Why shouldn't we rise to the challenge now? Through school, community, and government activities, in some ways we are. But we need to continue to do more to widen those pockets of inspiration and learning. The challenge does continue. What is the challenge? It is the search for true sisterhood and brotherhood. For true sister brotherhood that cuts across social, ethnic, religious, national, and economic lines. Our work confronts us. Our responsibilities are clear. The challenge is now. Think about that. Reverend James Taylor will give the invocation at this moment. And after Reverend Taylor has given the invocation, we will be led by the circuit riders in the singing of Lift Every Voice and Sing. When you rise for the invocation, we'd like you to remain standing for the singing of the hymn, Lift Every Voice and Sing.
May we stand. Let us pray. Dear God, our Father, we come tonight, O God, in the precious name of your Son, Jesus, and we come, O God, thanking you for all of your blessings of the day, Lord. We ask you, God, now as we come tonight, remembering the life of Dr. King, O God, we pray that you would bless every heart, every mind, every soul that is here tonight, O God, that you will touch us in a way, O God, that we will always try to strive for the best in which Dr. King lived for he looked beyond the color of one's skin, but at the contents of one's heart. Lord, help us tonight, O God, to look beyond anything but love, that as we reach out, let us reach out to each other, knowing that as we reach to you, you are the one that can bridge the gap over whatever differences we may have, O God, that we all might come away victorious, O God, and leading a life that's pleasing unto thee. Bless, O God, all that we shall do tonight, that we will always give your name the glory, the honor, and the praise, for it's in your precious name we ask it. Amen.
The lyrics for Lift Every Voice and Sing is on the inside cover of your programs.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring, ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise to the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Darkness has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the facing the rising sun of a new day begun. Let us march on till victory is won.
Sing it, everybody,
God
with us.
God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, thou who hast brought us thus far on the way, thou who hast by thy might led us to the light, keep us forever in the path we pray. Lest our feet stray from the blessings our God friendly met me. Lest our feet drunk with the wine of the world we forget thee. Shadowed beneath thy hand, may we forever stand true to our God, true to our native land, true to our God.
What we consider the Negro National Anthem. And I think they need to have some more. A student at Mamaroneck High School. I'm sorry. Kelly Slansky is a student at Mamaroneck High School, and she's in a video program. A few years ago, she co-produced another production for us. This time, she was really solo producer. It is called The Dream Is Our Future.
This is an NBC News Hotline special report. Here is Don Hickman in Memphis.
Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was shot outside a Memphis motel this afternoon. His condition is not known at this time. Police said the assailant apparently jumped into a late model white car after the shooting and sped away.
Repeating that bulletin, Dr. Martin Luther King was shot outside a Memphis hotel this evening. His condition not immediately known, but he was taken to a hospital. Lou Wood, NBC News, New York.
To me, Dr. King's dream was for people of all races and creeds and religion to come together as human beings, and I think that we're trying hard, our generation, to reach that dream, but I think we've got a way to go, because the only way that you can really fulfill that dream, I think, is probably by helping your fellow man. That means that if I have someone who I know who's black, we've got to help each other, otherwise we'll forever be at the bottom of what's going on. If I have a friend who's white, we've got to help each other, otherwise we'll never rise to the top.
It's a personal thing, it's a one-to-one thing. You treat every human being equally. And I think this is the main way to build hope for the future.
In the comings of achieving Martin Luther King's dream, I think that we as a people have come very far, mainly because of the fact that all the privileges that the black people have today that they didn't have back then. I think Martin Luther King would be happy if he saw what we were doing today compared to what was going back then. As far as how far we have to go to achieve the dream, not that far. I mean, there's a little bit of things that need work, but we can get there.
I think that for us to truly achieve Martin Luther King's dream, we will need for everybody to be viewed in the same unbiased way that sports figures are viewed. People idolize Michael Jordan or Magic Johnson, and it's not just black kids that idolize them. It's white kids and black kids alike, because they view them as though they had no color. And that's the way people need to be viewed in general, not just sports figures, but everybody. When everybody can view their neighbor or someone they meet in the street, regardless of what color they are, then we'll truly have achieved Martin Luther King's dream.
I've had a lot of experiences, some hurt, some when I felt left out, but yet I was with a group of friends who I'm still friends today who have been very caring and helpful to me, community people who've helped my family, who've helped me, who've helped my children when they went to college. And I think Mamaroneck has really grown, and I think that's what America's all about, is for people being different, yet respecting each other, and I think that's a big step.
In the days of Elvis Presley, a lot of people were reluctant to have their children doing the kind of dance that he was doing, but actually I think he got that dance from the blacks. I really believe that started, that, you know, when it came one to open, and they wanted to pull their children away from that kind of dancing, but it took on. You can't hold young people back, because they want to go forward. They want to live as a nation, not separated, but equally.
Every year I go to a place called Pinecrest, which is a church camp. It's a wonderful place. There's teenagers from all over the country. We look at each other as one. We understand each other. We spend time together. But after spending a week there, coming home, realizing the difference between the two places, I realize it's not the same. I'm sure if Martin Luther King was alive now and saw Pinecrest, I'm sure he wished the world was the same.
I think the way that we can achieve Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s dream is by opening our hearts a little bit and seeing more to people than what's on the outside. And if we aren't so quick to judge people, then maybe we'll have a better understanding of what they're all about, and we'll have a better understanding of their religion and their culture and their faith, and that way we can make more friends rather than making more enemies.
Many years ago, I worked for Elmsford Daycare Center. And I used to take my little sister with me. I was 18, my sister was probably about 7. And we were the only white people there. And I used to bring her almost every day, and she would play with the other kids, and she had a great time, and I liked working there. And one day, I said to this little girl, could you go find my sister? It's time to leave. And the little girl looked at me and she said, well, with all these kids here, how am I gonna know which one is your sister? Now her brother was standing right there and he said, you are so silly. Just look at her and look at us. And the little girl looked down and she looked around, and then she looked at me and she went, oh, I know. She's the one that's wearing the blue dress, just like you. So, wouldn't it be great if we all looked at each other that way? I think for the future, to realize Dr. King's dream, that's what we need to do. We have to look at one another where I say, oh, sure, you mean the lady with the blue dress and the girl with the yellow shirt. I think that would be realizing Dr. King's dream. That's the only colors we need.
It's my pleasure to announce the receipt of several proclamations honoring the award recipients for their efforts in advancing the principles of human rights in the memory of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr. The following elected officials have recognized both awardees from their respective jurisdictions and called today Olga Ochoa and Martha Lopez Day in their respective jurisdictions. U.S. Representative in Congress, Nita Lowey. Westchester County Chairman of the Board of Legislators, George Latimer. Supervisor of the Town of Mamaroneck, Valerie Moore O'Keefe. Mayor of the Village of Mamaroneck, Deborah Chapin. Mayor of the Village of Larchmont, Cheryl Louie. We thank all of them for their efforts and support for Human Rights Commission, especially Chairman Latimer for his unwavering dedication and final success in the passage of the Westchester County Human Rights Law and the establishment of the County Commission. He understood well the need for the County Commission and advocated on his behalf. Thank you.
Now we'd like Glenner to come up.
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, and recognize the dignitaries.
Right, I do that every year. Oh, the lights. Where's that young man? The lights, please.
While Glenner is doing that.
Better.
Glenn,
yes, Coral, what do you want me
minute?
To do?
Would the PACE two people start to?
All righty. You know, my job is to recognize all of the dignitaries, as Cora just said. So, at your seat, look to your left. Look to your right. Look in front of you. Look at your hands. You have looked at dignitaries. Everyone in the room is a dignitary. However, there are still some organizations within our community that I would like to recognize. Of course, my mayor, where's my mayor? There she is, mayor of the Village of Larchmont. Thank you for coming. Also, we have another female mayor. Debbie Chapin, where are you? Oh, you're sitting next to each other. And we also have a female for town supervisor. She, unfortunately, is not here. Valerie broke her ankle. So, but I think it's fabulous. We have three women at the head of government. Also, the Board of Education. Where are you ladies? I know you're always sitting back there near the back of the row. You want to run out before the period's over? Where are the Board of Ed? Oh, you see that? Ready to run out before the period's over. The head of our Board of Education is a woman. Yes, Dr. King. The president of the Board of Education is a woman. Barbara Rones. Get the other name, come on. Barbara Bennett Rones. Oh, I've messed it up twice before. We are living in a unique community in Westchester County. I've been involved in the women's movement now for about 25 years, and I can't believe that I have opportunities to say a woman does it, a woman. I think it's wonderful. We also have with us the Ed Woods. Where are you, Mr. Woods? Here you are. He is the principal of Wryneck Middle School. Thank you for coming. We've never met. Thank you. I believe you're having a board meeting tonight, and that's why the superintendent couldn't come. We also have a teacher from Wryneck, but he also assisted with the program. Now, Board of Ed, Village, Town, who did I miss? George Latham, George, where are you? Oh, there you are, George. Well, we'll find a woman for your spot and move you up the ladder. That's okay. I'll look for a woman to take your spot, then you can move up. Who else did I miss? I also see past recipients of our award. Here's one of our past recipients I see. Who brought the ambulance service to Larchmont Mamaroneck. I see another recipient over here. Where did I see the other? Miss Garland, where did I see? Back there, yes. Are there any other recipients that I'm missing? I don't know why this young man has these lights in my eyes. I can't see a thing. Are any other recipients here? I don't want to miss anyone. Oh, Wexler, right, another one. All right. Who else? Keith? Oh, Keith, sorry. The royal family of Mamaroneck, the Yizer family. Thank you. Well, the young people are ready, and youth must be served, so I will disappear. Excuse me.
Thank you.
attention for 2 seconds. I want to recognize Debbie Slansky. Come up here, Debbie. The young lady, Kelly. Oh God, my head. Kelly. When I met Kelly, she was a little girl in elementary school. This is the producer editor of the video that we saw on Martin Luther King. Yes. This is Kelly Slansky. And Mama Slansky is out there and Daddy Slansky is out there. And on behalf of the Nautilus Diner, one of our benefactors, supporters, the Nautilus Diner, 24 hours a day on Boston Post Road. You have coupons in there and you can take someone to lunch.
Thank you.
Sorry to interrupt.
The next group will be dance performers. And they are the Voces Unidas. And their advisor is Ms. Shannon Porter. Ms. Shannon Porter, am I missing a name? Ms. Shannon Turner Porter. I've known Shannon for a very long time. And I would like to take this particular opportunity to recognize the great work that she has done with students for a very long time. We've been doing this program for 13 years. Ms. Porter has been doing this program for much longer. When Dr. Schlick used to have a district-wide tribute to Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And I think we need to say that now. Okay? I'd also like to tell you that Mr. Lee Bloom is recovering from surgery. And he asked me, his wife called me to say that he was sorry he could not be here. Lee has been a long-standing member of the Human Rights Commission, a very dedicated and devoted person. And we wish him a speedy recovery. Now, the dancing of Voces, I'm going to try to say it better. Voces Unidas. And Ms. Shannon Turner Porter will introduce them.
Good evening. It is always great to return to the Emlyn. And this year is very special because we do have new people. It is a time for us to reflect on our past, what we've been doing, and the honor of Dr. King. It reminds me of my days growing up in North Carolina, doing the segregated society, my days of demonstration, going to jail, and fighting for a real cause. I saw Dr. King when I was a freshman in college. He came to speak, and I was just so amazed at a man who could just talk without using the paper, and he was just wonderful, and he really inspired me. I would like for my group of Voces Unidas to please come on the stage. Is this a small point? About 4 years ago, I have guys here. Oh, natural. Okay. About 4 years ago, two young ladies came to me, Jamie Velez, Maria Arameo, who are now in college, and said we want to form a club called the Voces Unidas. And it took some time to get started. We had meetings with maybe 3 people. But in the past year, the club has grown. The young people you see here have done a lot of interesting things, and they have a lot of energy. At this point, I want them to take their position. I'm going to say something else, and we'll get started with the dance, okay? All right, I would like to just say a couple quotes of Dr. King before the group comes on, and I think it's something that we should remember, some of his quotes, as Mrs. Gray's done earlier. He said once, darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. Hate multiplies hate. Violence multiplies violence. and toughness multiplies toughness in a descending spiral of destruction. The chain reaction of evil, hate begetting hate, wars producing more wars, must be broken, or we shall be plunged into the dark abyss of annihilation. Like an unchecked cancer, hate corrodes the personality and eats away its vital unity. Hate destroys a man's sense of values and his objectivity. It causes him to describe the beautiful as ugly and the ugly as beautiful, and to confuse the true with the false and the false with the true. Tonight is also very special because the person who's been on it, Mrs. Lopez, I've known for several years. I taught her two students. And so this dance, which would demonstrate some of the energy of our young people, is dedicated to you, Mrs. Lopez, and to Mamarinik. And at this time now, our voices, Anita's, will dance.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Now we're going to have a stage presentation, and it's entitled, You've Got to Be Taught. The students who are going to perform are from Rhinek High School, and their advisor has been Mr. Eric Lutinski.
What would Dr. King have thought about race relations in our new millennium? Would he be pleased or disappointed? Probably somewhere in between. One thing is certain, though. If all the babies born in 1968 grew up in a world of tolerance and colorblindness, those babies, the adults of today and the leaders of the year 2000, would help to shape a better environment. If we want to realize Dr. King's dream now, we have to start with the children. Using the actual thoughts of real children, as seen in the book, Dear Dr. King, here's a look at a classroom whose kids do not accept prejudice.
Good morning, class.
Good morning, Mr. Abramson.
Today I'm going to read you a poem called You've Got to Be Taught. You've got to be taught to hate and fear. You've got to be taught from year to year. It's got to be drummed in your dear little ear. You've got to be carefully taught. You've got to be taught to be afraid of people whose eyes are oddly made, and people whose skin is a different shade. You've got to be carefully taught. You've got to be taught before it's too late, before you are 6 or 7 or 8, to hate all the people your relatives hate. You've got to be carefully taught. Since we've been working on prejudice and how Dr. Martin Luther King told us not to prejudge people on color or race, I'd like you to write a letter to Dr. King telling him about the way things are now. You may begin. Okay, time's up. Who would like to read their letter first? Brendan, how about you?
Dear Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., thank you for helping stop racism. You were very brave to lead all those marches, especially in the streets. I can't believe you survived going to jail 3 times. I'm mad at that dumb man who shot you. When I heard that part in the stories, I had to go into my shirt, because I didn't want to show my tears.
Chris?
Dear Dr. King, last year on the news, I heard about a little boy who brought a gun into school. I want to know, what would you say to that young boy? A few years ago, I heard about some young men, black and white, that robbed an old lady's house. What I'm wondering is that if those people were in your family and did that, would you still love this person like you always did? Or would you not even talk to them?
Julie?
Dear Martin, my name is Julie. I'm 11 years old. I was shot, but unlike you, I was lucky. I survived. People fought for your birthday to become a national holiday. Everyone and every school celebrates your birthday and Black History Month in February. We had a program at school called Let's Join Hands for a Better World in honor of you. My neighborhood is neat. There's a lady on my street who is 75 years old. She volunteers to have Bible study every Tuesday at 4:30. Everyone is welcome. She always talks about you. My country, I'm sorry to say, is getting worse. At first, it seemed to be getting a little better. Now it's kids having kids and children killing children. People now aren't going to see reality until it's too late. I'm sorry you were shot. I would have taken your bullet. I wish you were still alive to tell people what they are doing to each other is wrong. Who are your heroes? Because you are ours.
Diego?
Dear Dr. King, maybe if you were here today, you would be happy. Maybe not. There's no segregation, but there's racism and hate. I must live with much racism in my family, my neighborhood, and our world. I cannot let go of their weapons and instead hold each other's hands. You had a dream that turned into a nightmare, and you lost your life.
Lauren?
Dear Dr. King, if you were alive today, I would like to honor you for all the hard work that you've done for America. I honor the fact that you were trying to make laws fair when you went to jail, got beaten, and risked your life for us. On your birthday, me and my family read your whole speech out loud, and we sing songs that you sang. What I'm trying to say is that things like the laws have changed since your death. You succeeded in what you wanted to accomplish. I am just sorry that you're not here to know. With peace and happiness, I want to say, I love you, Dr. King, in a very special way.
Doug?
Dear Dr. King, America needs another hero like you, one who stopped violence, who cared for the people, not just money. When I grow up, I may be a lawyer or a speaker. I, too, one day hope to be a great American hero. Forget me not, for I shall not forget you.
Ebony?
Dear Dr. King, I've heard so much about you. My mom said you want equal rights for everyone. My dad said you liked children and taught them how to solve problems without hitting. My teacher said you won a prize of money and gave all of it back to work for peace. I like you, and I wish I could see you. Your friend, Ebony.
And Ian? Yeah.
Dear Dr. King, this poem is my way of asking you a very important question. The question is, why did you sacrifice your life? And why did you feel you were the one God was calling? Why? Why did you not declare war? Some people think you were a bore. I know you wanted equal laws, and it really was a worthy cause. But why did you have to lose your life and leave your children and your wife? I know they're glad you helped the world, but what about your sons and your little girls? They have to go on without your touch. I know this hurts them very much. Imagine how they felt that day when you were shot and went away. Still, you were a hero in their eyes, and none could beat a bigger prize.
Very good prize. If more people felt like you, the world would be a happier place. Oh, there's the bell.
Hi, my name is Lauren Talevi, and I'm a senior at Rhinek High School. I also am an honorary member of the Human Rights Commission. As an honorary member, I represent students from Largemont and the Maranick. The Human Rights Commission is dedicated to promoting tolerance, not only in the streets of Maranick and Largemont, but in the schools as well. In doing so, we decided to hold a contest open to all students at Maranick and Rhinek High Schools to design a logo that would represent the Human Rights Commission. The commission received approximately 200 entries from talented students at both districts. It was very difficult, but the commission finally decided on a winner. Melissa Sidoroff is a freshman at Mamaroneck High School. Her logo represents the Human Rights Commission particularly well, and she was quite inspiring to all in writing, "Apart we are nothing, together we are one." On behalf of the commission, I would like to congratulate Melissa on her creative and inspiring logo that will be used to represent Mamaroneck and Largemont's commitment to promoting tolerance. Melissa, could you please come up and receive this plaque and your check as a sign of appreciation and admiration by the Human Rights Commission?
The circuit riders are very privileged to be here tonight, and we're very thankful to be invited to play for this event. which I've attended for a number of years. We're usually a church rock band. There's 10 members, and tonight we're unplugged except for the bass. If you want to hear us plug, this is a plug. We play on Sunday night. We produce a show called Sunday Night Live. It's an alternative church service. And next Sunday, this coming Sunday, we'll be in the auditorium at where that pretty little wooden church on the Post Road is, on the left as you're heading towards Rye. And in the back, we have a program at 6:30. I'd like to introduce two people. And we have a new pastor as of this last summer. And Glenna, guess what? It's a she. Pastor Linda Lee Stein is out there somewhere. Darn these lights, right, Glenna? And our associate pastor, Chuck Van Houten.
You stole my line. But Glenna, on behalf of the United Methodist Church, Mamaroneck, I just want to thank you for inviting us to be a part of this very special night to celebrate the life and the ministry of a man who truly knew what it meant to walk as Jesus walked and to be with the people who needed him and just basically to take the gospel to the world and be a part of that and try and make some sense out of it all. So we thank you for inviting us to be a part of this night.
You who are on the road must have a code that you can live by, and so become yourself, because the past is just a goodbye. Teach your children well. Their father's hell did slowly go by, and feed them on your dreams, the one they picks, the one you'll know by. Don't you ever ask them why, if they told you you would cry, so just look at them and sigh, and know they love you. And you, of tender years, can't know the fears that your elders grew by, and so please help them with your youth. They seek the truth before they can die. Teach your parents well, and the children's hell will slowly go by, and feed them on your dreams, the one they picks, the one you'll know by. Don't you ever ask them why, if they told you you would cry, so just look at them and sigh, and know they love you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? But there they carried us away in captivity, requiring of us a song. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? Let the words of our mouths and the meditation
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Bruce Williams, and I'm a member of the Tri-Municipal Human Rights Commission. And as I've been doing for the last several years, I have the pleasure this evening of introducing our guest speaker. Reverend W. Darren Moore is currently the pastor of Greater Centennial African Methodist Episcopal Zion Church in Mount Vernon, New York. previous pastoral assignments have included Clarksville and Morning Star AME Zion churches in Monroe, North Carolina, Mount Olivet AME Zion Church in Greensboro, North Carolina, and James Tabernacle AME Zion Church in Indianapolis, Indiana. Reverend Moore received his college training at Livingstone College in Salisbury, North Carolina, which, as most of you know, is one of the renowned historically black colleges and universities that played such a major role in educating black Americans during the last century and a half. A campus leader during his college times, Reverend Moore served as president of the Student Government Association as well as national president of the Pre-Alumni Association of the United Negro College Fund. Reverend Moore has consistently provided significant civic leadership in addition to his ecclesiastical responsibilities. While in Greensboro, for example, he served on the commission of the local Coliseum and a county commissioner on children and youth. In Indianapolis, Reverend Moore served two terms as president and board of the board of directors of Greater Indianapolis, of the Greater Indianapolis Church Federation. He also served as a presiding elder for the Indianapolis district. And when I read that, for those of you who may not know the role and work of a presiding elder, I don't know if he was doing this while he was pastoring a church, because if he were, it would mean that he would be spending an awful lot of time on the road. A presiding elder usually oversees about, in the AME Zion denomination, between 20 and 25 churches, where you have to appear each quarter to preside over a quarterly conference. And as you could, if you do the math, you know that by the time you get through 25 churches doing quarterly conferences, it's time to start again going through those 25 churches. So, Reverend, you must have been a very busy man. Pastor Moore's leadership and involvement has continued since coming to Mount Vernon community. He has served as commissioner of the Mount Vernon Housing Authority and on the board of directors of the Mount Vernon Neighborhood Health Center. He is currently the founding chairperson of Save Our Seed Ministry, national director of young adults for the AME Zion Church, second vice president for the United Black Clergy of Westchester, and a member of the Mount Vernon Board of Education. And as a member of a board of education, that's a full-time job. In April of last year, Reverend Moore was appointed to the African American Advisory Board for Westchester County and serves as a host of other church and civic responsibilities. Reverend Moore is currently in his third year of study at Yale University School of Divinity. He's married to Davetta Moore, and they are proud parents of three children, Deron Moore, 13, Dana Moore, age 11, and Dion Moore, age 7. And the reason I give their last names is so that you can put those initials together. Note that everybody in the Moore family is first initials are D, and the second initials are, obviously, Moore. Understanding the call upon the church to be relevant force for good in society, Reverend Moore uses this as his theme. It is your outreach that validates your upreach. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Reverend Darren Moore.
Thank you, Bruce, for that introduction. As I was sitting there listening to his introduction, I realize I don't have time to be here tonight. the truth of the matter is that when I was in Indianapolis, it was a wonderful time, and I was pastoring and presiding elder at the same time. But in Indianapolis, the demographics are much different than they are here on the East Coast and in the South. And so, unlike the presiding elders in the North and the Southeast, in Indianapolis, I had a total of 8 churches under my jurisdiction, so it was manageable at that time. Let me thank the Human Rights Commission for this invitation. Bruce also mentioned that everybody in my household has the same initials. That helps with the monograms on the towels, but it also helps keeping names straight. I grew up in a house with four boys, and my mother used to always get our names mixed up. And so we learned to answer to any of our brothers' names. And so I decided to solve that problem by making certain all of my children's name begins with a D, and therefore when I get to calling them, I just say, "Hey, D, come here," and I'm always right. It is a pleasure and a privilege to have this opportunity to share on this very auspicious occasion. The program already has been so rich and wonderful that I have enjoyed participating in it. I am so very impressed with the diversity and the quality of involvement in this community. And so we celebrate you and congratulate you on this, your 13th anniversary. I am honored to have been asked to come and speak to you. And because I think they heard of my reputation of being a rather lengthy speaker, they were very clear and emphatic in the letter that they were on a time schedule. And they said that your speech is to be no longer than an hour, absolutely, definitely. And so I promise to adhere to that time frame as you have outlined. I thought a great deal about what to share with you this evening. And as I thought about the life of Dr. King and the impact that he had and continues to have, and the challenge of your theme, which calls us to awake, which I think in and of itself grabs us and suggests to us that maybe there are some ways in which we've been lulled to sleep, or we have been lulled into a sense of complacency that the work is done and that the dream is fulfilled. I challenge each of us in our own ways and in our own areas and spheres of influence to renew our sense of commitment to Dr. King's dream. I contend that Dr. King, unlike any other leader in the 20th century, impacted virtually every area of our lives. He was a voice for human rights globally, took stands on situations all around this world. He was an advocate for educational excellence. He was a vehicle and a strategist for economic empowerment for those who have been disenfranchised. In fact, he lost his very life working with the sanitation workers in Memphis, Tennessee. He was a strong leader for political enfranchisement, and he was one of the most effective voices for peace when many of his allies even suggested to him that he ought to be quiet about the war in Vietnam. Dr. King was one who stood on principle. And so for us today, it says that we cannot be satisfied because the agenda is not yet complete. The work still remains unfinished. Although tremendous strides have been made, much remains left undone. In 1957, speaking in Indiana at Purdue University, Dr. King, addressing that august body of students and intellectuals, said that if any of us are truly going to be successful, we have got to reject the narrow, superficial definition of what success is. We cannot engage in a type of materialism that says we are successful based on our financial net worth. But Dr. King sagaciously suggested that genuine success, that a genuine, complete life, is one that is three-dimensional. He suggests that if someone is truly going to be successful, they must exemplify what he would describe as the length of life, the breadth of life, and the height of life. And that is a critical challenge for us even into the 21st century. The length of life is one in which we are not defining the quantity of years, but rather the quality of one's experience.
Dr. King himself was what theologians would refer to as a symbiotic manifestation. In other words, he was an example himself of one who exemplified the length of life. He was one who was the consummate educator. He was one who was a paradigmatic professor. He was one who exemplified the efforts that it takes to be the very best that we can be. He is one that challenged us that we ought not to deny who we are, our heritage, our ethnicity, our religion, our culture, our economic and social backgrounds, but yet we ought not be defined and limited by who we are and where we come from. That he sagaciously suggested to each of us that we must constantly strive to reach beyond where we are. I suggest today that we renew our commitment to that cause, that we must be examples. We can't just talk the talk, we must walk the walk. That we must be examples. In fact, we must be what we want others to become. I read very, very sadly an article that was in the Washington Post several years ago, where a 15-year-old and 14-year-old young African-American girls, sat down and completely planned their funerals. They wrote out their obituaries. They chose the dresses that they would wear. They chose who they wanted to speak on the program because they sincerely believed that they would not live to graduate from high school. What you witnessed in that article, my brothers and sisters, is the death of hope. It is the demise of a sense of possibilities. It is the shortening of the length of life, again, not just in quantitative years, but in qualitative experience. And in very real ways, in many of our communities, you are finding young people who are losing a sense of hope, have lost a sense that things can be better than what they are right now. And so we, who are the heirs to Dr. King's dreams, must translate to them that what you are now and your current circumstances do not have to define what your future will become. You are more than what others label you. You are more than your superficial circumstances, for that which is in you is greater than that which is around you. It was this sense of prophetic voice that allowed Dr. King to speak hope in the most hopeless situations, to people who had been beaten and abused, to elderly women who had fire hoses turned on them, to mothers and fathers and children who had attack dogs sick on them, to persons who had no sense of possibility. Dr. King was able to speak with the prophetic voice, saying to them that there is a better day coming. My brothers and sisters, I have looked over into the promised land, and I may not get there with you, but we as a people will get to the promised land. It is this sense of hope that we must renew in the succeeding generations. Dr. King had that prophetic voice. And I must say that there's a lot of talk about the frailties and the fallibility of Dr. King. And I would remind us as persons of wisdom and insight that we ought not deny Dr. King's humanity. And in fact, what we ought to do is celebrate that in his humanity, in the midst of the human frailties, he was able to challenge each of us to press for the greatest possibilities that lies within us, the length of life. But Dr. King also said life is not enough if you just have the length of life. You can have a wonderful sense of who you are, and still life for you is not complete. For Dr. King says, inextricably connected with the length of life is the breadth of life. It's the width of life. It is the ability to understand that we are all connected one to the other. Modern writers are lamenting the demise of the front porch. You remember when you would sit on the front porch and everybody knew everybody? I was impressed with how many people Glenda knows in all of Mamaroneck. It seems like she knows everybody. But the truth of the matter is we're moving to a time now where things are changing rapidly. People are more likely to be in communication with people thousands of miles away over the internet than they are with their neighbors. We are not talking with one another face to face like we used to. We're not learning from one another who live across town from us and who have different backgrounds and different ethnicities. And Dr. King would say that it is critical that we reach out one to the other. There was a man who was walking along one day in the center of town, and he fell into a ditch that had been dug for some construction work. And there were a group of people who walked by. The first person who walked by was a subjective person, and he said, "You know, I feel sorry for you having fallen into that ditch." The objective person walked by and said, "It's only logical if you weren't looking that you would fall into that ditch." There was a realist that came by and said, "Yes, indeed, that looks to me like it is a ditch." There was one who had the mentality of self-righteousness and said, "If you only walked as carefully as I walk, you would never fall into the ditch." There was a self-pitying person who walked by and said, "Child, if you think that ditch is bad, you ought to wait to see the ditch that's waiting for me." There was a mathematician who walked by who wanted to calculate how deep the ditch was. There was a professor who walked by who wanted to give a lecture on the elementary principles of ditches. There was a philosopher who came by and said, "I wonder which came first, you or the ditch." There was a politician who came by and said, "Now if you vote for me in the primary, I'll outlaw ditches." There was a Democrat who came by who said, "Now, if you vote for me, what I will do is I'll set up a social program to get you up out of that ditch." There was a Republican that came by and said, "It's because of social programs that you're in that ditch in the first place." There was an IRS agent came by and said, "Have you paid taxes on your ditch?" The health inspector came by and said, "Do you have a certificate for that ditch?" A preacher, probably a Methodist preacher, came by and said, "I see 3 points about you being in that ditch." But one who is a brother and a sister, one who is in community, one who is in relationship, will reach down, grab a hold of the person, doesn't ask how you got into the ditch, doesn't ask who you are and what your background is, doesn't want to see a pedigree, but understands that because you are in the ditch, in a real sense, all of humanity is in the ditch, and we must reach down and pick one another up. That was and still is the challenge of Dr. King's dream. Because we're living today, in the year 2000, in a time of unparalleled economic prosperity. You and I, my brothers and sisters, are seeing our incomes increase, our net worth increase. In fact, just in the journal news, it indicated that in the last decade, that the majority of Americans saw an increase in their income and net worth of something like 17%. But those who are at the bottom rung in society actually saw a decrease of almost 25% in their income. My brothers and my sisters, we can never become so complacent and satisfied with where we are, with what our children are achieving, with what's happening in our community, that we can turn blind eyes to the pain and the suffering of those which are going on around you. One of the geniuses of Dr. King was that he understood that African Americans could not do it alone. And that's why Dr. King is not simply a great African American leader. He is not simply a great Black hero. He is a great he was a great American leader and a great American hero. For he mobilized across this country persons of goodwill of all ethnic backgrounds, Northerners and Southerners, Jews and Protestants and Catholics, and said to them that as long as any one of us is hurting and suffering, then in a real sense, all of us are hurting and suffering. And that message echoed around the world, so that now in South Africa and in every corner of this globe, there is a renewed call for human rights. Thank you, Dr. King, for that message. It reminds us that until we're reaching out to help others, we are indeed limited in who we are. I remember hearing a story many years ago about a man who dreamed a dream. I think I still have about 45 minutes to go and I'll close. I remember a story of a man who dreamed a dream, and he was escorted by an angel to the lower parts of existence. And there he saw a great banquet table with luscious, delicious, succulent foods all around the table. And yet, as he looked at the persons who were sitting around the table, they were all thin and bones protruding. Mouths were dry and lips were cracked. And he asked the angel, why is it that with all of this food and all that is in front of them, are these people looking as if they're starving? And the angel said, look at their hands. And on their hands, there were attached forks, but they were 4 feet long. So as they scooped up the food to bring it to their mouths, the forks were too long and the food would fall to the floor. The man said, this is too depressing. I've got to get up out of here. And so the angel escorted him to the heights of existence. And there was the same banquet table. But the people who were sitting around the table looked satisfied and pleased and were all eating. And the man said, but look, they have the same forks, 4 foot long forks in their hands. But the angel said, but look at how they behave. Instead of scooping up the food and feeding themselves, they scooped up the food and leaned across the table and they fed the person on the other side. And as they fed them, they were fed in return. That's what we must be about in the 21st century. Let me congratulate you on honoring two women, Martha and Olga, whose lives are dedicated to reaching out and helping others. But let's not just suffice it by giving them a plaque and an award for what they do. But let each of us commit ourselves anew to reaching out. Now finally, and I do mean finally, I'm not like the Apostle Paul, who when he says finally, he has to say it 3 additional times before he really means finally. Dr. King said, when you have the length of life, and you have the breath of life, don't stop there, because it's shallow. It's two-dimensional. You must always claim the height of life. What a powerful prophetic insight. Because it says that none of us is just us, but that regardless of what our faith entails, that there is a power beyond us. And I appreciate the fact that Dr. King never apologized for the fact that he was a man of faith. And in fact, as these wonderful young people read these letters and asked, how could you sacrifice your life? Why were you willing to die? I am reminded that it was not just the length of life and the breadth of life that gave King his conviction that he must be about this business, but it was a sense of divine mandate. It was a sense that there was a power beyond himself that was guiding human history, and that he was simply an instrument that must be used in helping to transform this world. In fact, it was late one night, January the 30th, 1956. His wife, Cora, had gone to bed. And his daughter, Yolanda, had been tucked in. There was an explosion. A bomb had been thrown through his window. Dr. King checked on his family. After making certain that they were all safe and they had gone back to sleep after the commotion had died down, he himself says that he went to his kitchen, fixed himself a cup of coffee, sat there, and with tears in his eyes, said to himself, "I'm quitting. I'm giving up. It's not worth it. There's too much hate in this world. There's too many people who are vicious." And as he sat there, he felt the presence of a power greater than himself. And over that cup of coffee, he began to do what his foreparents did. And when he said, "I had a little talk with Jesus, I told him all about my trouble." And he began to tell him, "God, I graduated at 19 years old from Morehouse College. I went on to receive a Master's of Divinity degree from Crozat Seminary. I just last year received a PhD in systematic theology from Boston University. But right now, all of my education won't do me any good. All of my intellect, all of my academic achievements, all of my accolades will do me no good. I need the faith that Grandmama used to talk about. I need the faith that my daddy used to talk about. I need to know that there's a power that's got a hold of me, that when the enemy wants to do its worst, I know that I will not lose, for no weapon formed against me shall prosper." And Dr. King said it was then that he heard a voice speaking to him, and it became like a wheel in the middle of a wheel. What he felt was the power of God. What he felt was Adam's creator and Noah's ark of safety, Abraham's waymaker, Joseph's deliverer, Sarah's faith, Moses' burning bush, David's song, Jeremiah's fire, Mary's baby, Paul's prison door opener, Harriet Tubman's engine of deliverance, Sojourner Truth's message of freedom, Frederick Douglass's Northern Star. He heard Marcus Garvey's burning spear and Jomo Kenyatta's faith that would not shrink. It was Nelson Mandela's Robben Island prison door opener. It was Malcolm X's faith in a God greater than himself. And it was Martin Luther King's dream giver. God will be with you. If you reach out and reach in, then reach up, and the God which is above you will pick you up and will bless you and give you the victory. Keep the dream alive. God bless you and thank you.
I can't believe I have to follow that. Well, my name is Robin Achinsky. I'm a member of the Human Rights Commission, and I can't match that, but I have something very special to say. It's my pleasure tonight to introduce to you this year's recipients of the Martin Luther King Jr. Award, Martha Lopez and Olga Ochoa. Martha. Martha and Olga have been recognized most recently for their work in establishing the Larchmont Mamaroneck Hispanic Resource Center, where they are rendering an invaluable and very much needed service to our community. Their work at the Resource Center is but the latest in a long list of community efforts that these two women, together and individually, have tirelessly engaged in over the years. At the Washingtonville Housing Alliance, Martha has worked since 1984 helping members of our community find affordable housing and educating our citizens about housing issues. Recently, she also helped others find employment through the Employment for Larchmont and Mamaroneck Center. She has acted as a liaison and advisor to the Hispanic community, serving on the Westchester County Hispanic Advisory Committee, the Westchester Hispanic Coalition, as an interpreter in the Village Court and Police Department, and many other capacities. Olga has been no less ambitious. She has supported numerous families through her work at the Mamaroneck Avenue School, and countless others as a community outreach worker for the Village of Mamaroneck. She has volunteered for the Larchmont Mamaroneck Hunger Task Force, has also acted as a translator, liaison, and advisor for the Hispanic community, as well as other local organizations helping parents, children, and the elderly. And both Olga and Martha have previously been honored here for their efforts with Voce Vida, a Latino self-help organization which helped foster good community relations. In short, Martha and Olga have served as indispensable resources in our community. In doing so, they've helped us all and helped bring us all together in the spirit of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. On behalf of the Human Rights Commission, we thank you both by giving you this award tonight. Very heavy.
Good evening, members of our wonderful community. I can't describe how honored I feel tonight. I am grateful to the Human Rights Commission for selecting me to receive this award. This is a great privilege. However, the honor really must go to the brave people who struggle daily to achieve their dreams of raising their families in this country and in this community. I want to honor these new citizens and those trying to become citizens who work so very hard, often for wages that are very low. I want to honor those people who endure hardship and cruelty with dignity and hope. I want to honor those people who lack the opportunity of an education, yet strive so hard to ensure that their children will attend schools of excellence. My work is very gratifying. I have an opportunity to give back to my people and my neighborhood. I have had the privilege of working beside many generous and caring people. Together we can and need to come together to alleviate suffering and advance the opportunity to all our residents. This will benefit us all. Our unique community moves steadily towards reaching the Reverend Martin Luther King's dream of equal opportunity for all. Together, we can make this dream a reality. And once again, thank you all for making this great honor possible.
I want to thank the Human Rights Commission. I know that there are many people in our community who have worked very hard, and they are all deserving of the Martin Luther King Award. This award to Olga and I is a very special award. It's even more special because we are the first Hispanic individuals to receive it. While thinking what my speech was going to cover tonight, I serendipitously was at a place where a woman was reading the lyrics of a song. Her name is Roberta. And when she read those lyrics, I said, oh, can I have a copy of that? And I would like to share this with you. The song is by James Taylor. And it says, so let us turn our thoughts today to Martin Luther King and recognize that there are ties between us, all men and women living on the earth, ties of hope and love, sister and brotherhood, and we are bound together in our desire to see the world become a place in which our children can grow free and strong. We are bound together by the task that stands before us and the road that lies ahead. And we are bound, we are bound. Dr. King's vision was for all of us to bind together. Dr. King was a unifier. I remember seeing the rebroadcast of a speech where he included Mexican Americans and people of color. He spoke about the oppression that they too had. We were included in his dream. As end to end, I would like for all of us to think back on James Taylor's song. We are bound, we are bound. And with that in mind, let's get all of us to the dream, to the dreamland. Thank you. To the promised land. Thank you.
Thank you, Martha and Olga.
Excuse me, I have an announcement. I would like to invite all of you to celebrate the Hispanic heritage of a benefit of the Hispanic Resource Center. Please join us on February 11 at 7:30 p.m. here at the Emeline Theater for the Westchester premiere of the film La Ciudad, an acclaimed film about the immigrant experience in New York. Thank you.
Martha and Olga received bookends, which are our traditional gift. And it says on the bookends that she lives the dream.
Well, I shall not keep you long. I'm Jeffrey Weiner, and I'm also a member of the Tri-Municipal Human Rights Commission. It's my duty to close the meeting and to invite you to come out to the front of the theater and enjoy cookies and other things and get to know one another. That's the theme of this whole celebration, is it not? So, with that, I do close this section of the meeting, but there are two musical renditions following the closing. Also, make sure you look at the art exhibit outside, done by our school youngsters.
Has anybody here seen my old friend Abraham? Can you tell me where he's gone? He freed a lot of people, but we've seen the good die young. I looked around. Anybody here seen my old friend Martin? Can you tell me where he's gone? He freed a lot of people, but we've seen the good die young. I just looked around.
At this point, we'd just like to ask you all to turn to the last page in your program and join us in the singing of We Shall Overcome.
We shall overcome. We shall overcome. We shall overcome someday. Oh, deep in my heart, I do believe we shall.
Lord will see us through. Lord will see us through. The Lord will see us through.
Good night, everyone. Good night. Enjoy the refreshments.
Police said the